Are you in your element at a WonderCon, Comic-Con type thing, or no?
This is my first one.
Really?
Yeah, this is my first one. So I don't know. You tell me. How am I doing?
Doing awesome.
Great. Which one of these can I tap into and say, is this thing on? All of them?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Are these things on? That'll be fun.
Nice.
Post.
Okay, I have to ask about the Price is Right episode. Mm-hmm. How fun was that for you to play out?
It was so much fun. I had a lot of anxiety, really. Ari did that day. But my parents were in the audience. You can actually see them in the back of the shot. There's a guy who, my father, he's of Moroccan descent, so his skin tone is a little bit darker than mine. But he's like, his eyes are bugging out of his head. And like my friend and assistant and my parents are all there. They're wearing pink shirts that say "Pick Me." You can see them right on the edge of frame. You can see him. His eyes are going crazy. So it's fun. My family was there. Drew Carey. I've been an improviser since I was 13, 14. So pretty crazy. Grew up on Whose Line Is It Anyway. Got to like do comedy with Drew Carey. What an amazing day. Probably one of my favorite days.
Like a bucket list item. Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Would you normally in real life be good at Price is Right?
I don't know. I don't think so. My character had to memorize a bunch of stuff. And I'm good at memorizing things, but I don't know if I could tediously memorize it. Going on the Price is Right and just sort of saying like, okay, well that'll be X and that'll be Y. And I don't know if I could do that. I'd probably be like, what is everybody else saying? And then I'll do like a dollar under that. Like that might be my tactic. Might be a little bit basic, but yeah.
I mean, you've gotten some story out of that. I'm sorry, your character's name?
Sylvester,
sorry about that.
No, okay.
You know, he won money and for the foundation, but he still doesn't have enough money. And now you've hired a lawyer. What can you tease about that story as we're going on?
It certainly gets picked up in a way that not many people thought it would. It's not like on the nose, we jump back into the storyline, but it's all for the same thing, the Megan Dodd Pediatric Care Wing or Ward. I don't know which one that they're calling it nowadays. But that is very much a part of the plot of the last two episodes of this season, because of the highly publicized nature of The Price is Right and certain things that went in motion during those episodes. I can't really talk too much about it, but the things that got sort of in that episode and following because of The Price is Right, Scorpion might have a little bit too much publicity on them.
Oh.
Something like that.
So coming up, the team's going to try to break into Fort Knox.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the team's done a lot of amazing things, but Fort Knox is supposed to be the pinnacle of not being able to break in. Can you talk a little bit about that assignment?
Fort Knox. Well, the way we get the initial assignment is really suspect, and the team sort of goes like, which is cool, but there's an older white gentleman with a big bag of money, and he comes into the Scorpion office, and he says, we need your guys to test the security system at Fort Knox, because we're not really sure. And so you're going to enlist our help? And he's like, yeah, and you can't tell anybody that that's what's going to happen. We're like, I mean, that's really bad, because then real guns, real security guards are going to try and kill us. It's Fort friggin' Knox. And he's like, but this is how we're going to pay you. And just drops the big old bag of cash on the table, and he's like, it's $1 million cash. The U.S. government has your back. And so the whole episode is like, do they really have our backs? Do they really want us to test it? Or are we covering something up? And we don't really know. We reluctantly take the gig. And it's cool. I mean, it's one of those action, who's going to get it, episodes.
How does Sylvester handle that? Is he...
I'm rocking the Surface tablet by Microsoft back at the garage. Looking at the grids. No, it's a great episode. It's a great episode. I had fun shooting it. Sorry.
Are there any of these scripts that have, you've received them and said, we can't do that? What are they even thinking trying to pull that off?
You know, I'm waiting for Walter to surf on a tsunami. I think that'll be the one. But, no, that's funny. I would love to see somebody surf on a tsunami. I think somebody pitched that as an episode last year. I can't remember who it was. I've never seen something in the script that made me go, how do we do that since the pilot? Of how do we get a car to go right underneath it? After that, I was like, they're putting it in the script because they know how to do it.
Is he going to fly in the tornado coming up?
We just watched the tornado in there. Is who going to fly? Walter? I don't want to give it away. There is some tornado play, I will say.
Yeah. You guys have handled pretty much every disaster. You know, there's that earthquake episode that just happened, too. That's crazy.
It's nuts. I mean, I like that the second season we really went to the natural disasters where there really is no, there's no face of a villain. I think, I mean, I don't know. I hope that we get to see, like, a real evil person next season. That'd be cool. But who knows?
Have they told you anything about what's happening with season 3?
We got picked up.
Yeah, but what's going to be happening? Have they given you any hints of how they're developing it?
Well, they love cliffhangers. Yes. So how do you follow up more cliffhangers with more cliffhangers?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I mean, I think that's what they're going to do, more cliffhangers. It's such a fun show. I mean, I don't know. I think doing what they're doing is great. Like, they got a plan. I trust them.
So season 2 is going to end on a cliffhanger? Is that what you're saying? Like, literally hanging off the cliff?
No, I think we did that. We did that first season. No. Nobody's going to be hanging off a cliff, but I think people will be sitting on the edge of their seats going like, well, why now? You know, I think it'll be good.
Is there anything you've discovered about yourself from playing this guy?
Yes. I am not as anxious as he is.
Hmm.
Yeah.
That's good to know.
I thought I had, like, a lot more in common with him, and this year I learned that I really don't. Which is awesome, because I don't know, I get to, like, learn about him with every script, and that helps me, I guess, develop myself. I'm 23, so it's a lot of self-development going on still.
Mm-hmm.
That's all I'll say.
I mean, what was it like to play out the whole Megan storyline? Because that was really sad and touching. And
thank you. I love doing that. When they first said, we're going to start a romance with these two characters, I was very excited to show a different kind of love on TV. I thought it was really cool that I was part of a project that was deciding to do that. And it's like way purer than any like love that I know in real life, which is cool. Because it's living in this sort of twilight of somebody's life. So it's really heavy. I mean, it's far heavier than I thought I'd ever go on a show like Scorpion, which is sort of action-adventure, fun time. So it was fun, I guess is the thing I'd say. It was a lot of fun because it also taught me a lot about myself as an actor, and I was able to find levels and how I thought of him. And yeah, a lot of discovery. It was great. It was great. I hope it turned out all right. I learned so much during that time. Camille is such an incredible actor to work with.
Do you think that as Sylvester continues to bond with the team through time, that will help him overcome more of this anxiety that he has? Or do you think he's at a level where it's pretty much going to stay at that level of anxiety?
You know, I always think about how Sylvester wants to be always. You know, I feel like there's this normal that people are trying to get to, and they're sort of in their early 20s. They're like, how do I get to this plateau of, like, this is where my life is? And Sylvester had that sort of thing in him. How do I get to the plateau of what's normal when he was 6? Because his brain is so advanced. So I think as a 22, 23-year-old genius, I think he likens himself to knowing himself as sternly as a stubborn 80-year-old person who's been doing it forever, because he knows the facts harder in his head than anywhere else. But that's sort of how Megan got to him, is, no, you should change and you should adapt to the world around you, because that's, as a human being, like, your brain might be more advanced, but your body, the truth of the situation, you got to be sacrificing to do it. Nobody else can do it. So I think that is setting him up to develop further. But if you asked him, he'd say, no, I'm not going to change. Is that too wordy of an answer?
That makes sense.
Cool. Awesome.
How much has changed this season? We got to meet his dad. Are we going to find out more about the time between when he left home and when he met up with Walter?
I really hope so. That really intrigues me, especially because, like, I don't know. I can't remember exactly what made it into the cut of episode 9, season 1, but there was talk of Sylvester hacking a bank. I think that might still be canon. He hacks a bank, and then Walter catches him hacking the bank and gives him a shot with Scorpion. So I'd love to see that story, and I'd love to see all the other hijinks that they got in before Cade comes back. I think, yeah, that'd be really cool. I, only as a fan, can say I'd love to see that. I don't know what they're planning.